Okay, let's finish up on our video series on Islam by talking about the economy. So the Muslim empires were very, very wealthy for the most part. A lot of this was due to the religious toleration that existed within the Islamic world. This promotes a large amount of trade from a wide variety of areas. So for example, products from China and Southeast Asia go all the way to Spain, and from there, they're traveling throughout the rest of Europe. There was an achievement in seafaring technology that facilitated trade. These were ships called dhows. They originally developed in India or China, we're not sure, and they had very long, thin hulls. So because of that, they were excellent for carrying goods, but they were less useful for warfare, so very vulnerable. And one of the continuing legacies of the Islamic influence over Spain in particular is in its architecture. So this image here is the outside of present-day Granada. It's the Alhambra Palace, which was built in the 13th century. So this is Spain. Also, we see significant contributions to culture and education from the Muslim world into Europe, and one of the examples of that would be that Cordoba, which is a city in Spain, at that point during the Umayyad Caliphate, the Cordoba Library was the biggest in the world. Also, Ibn Rushdie, who we see pictured here, was known in Europe as Averroes. He lived in the 12th century, and he wrote influential books on law, secular philosophy, and the natural sciences. And so his knowledge was certainly carried on into the Western world. And also Maimonides was a significant Jewish scholar in Spain. So we see that extent of religious toleration that exists there. Pardon my mispronunciation again. In any case, as far as social and cultural life was concerned, the Islamic world was fragmented politically, but very advanced culturally. Trade brought in new goods and fresh ideas throughout the Islamic world. And universities cropped up in cities like Baghdad, Cordoba, Cairo, and Bukhara, which is located in Central Asia. And studies went far beyond religious teachings. So you see examples of Islamic scholars translating Greek literary classics into Arabic. They saved the works of Aristotle and other Greek thinkers. This is significant because at this time, Western Europe has plummeted into the Dark Ages. So if it were not for the wealth of the Muslim world, we may not have been able to experience the Renaissance in Western Europe. Those teachings may not have been preserved otherwise. Also, Islamic scholars brought back mathematic texts from India and papermaking from China. And there were medical advances in hospital care. Doctors actually took examinations for licenses that allowed them to practice medicine. And lastly, I would be remiss if I did not mention Omar Khayyam. He was a famous Persian writer, and he is best known for writing the Rubaiyat, which was a series of poems. And the left image here is the university at Cordoba. So again, we see the influence of Islamic architecture on a place in Spain, and it also shows us how important education was to the Muslim world. As far as the diaspora is concerned, there is development of more and more trade networks between coastal and interior societies. As we said earlier, for a while there was a lot of water trade, but you're seeing that as Islam spreads, there's an increasing combination of both coastal and land trade. And this trade allowed frequent contacts with other religions, mostly Judaism and Christianity. There was a strong loyalty between clan members, between the formerly Bedouin world. So we do see that there's some continuity way back to periods 1 and 2 there. And trade along the Red Sea created powerful merchant elites in many cities. Non-Arab areas also experienced Islamic expansion. There was control by Islamic caliphs that led to some discrimination towards non-Arab converts. But usually this was not open persecution. So in other words, as Islam spreads to places like Persia, which is not Arab in nature. It was difficult to a certain extent to practice Islam in this area, but not impossible. And then just going back to the Arabian Peninsula for one moment, I missed something here. Because the Red Sea trade created so many powerful merchants, this actually contributes to the growth of Mecca and Medina in particular, because they were stopped on long-distance camel trade routes. So mosques were very common in this area, and they provided a common base for social and cultural life. It was a place for merchants to stop and worship on their way. Of course, an area for trade, just an area that was very wealthy in terms of culture and spirituality. I already said that merchants become a prosperous class. This is more so than other societies in Europe or Asia at the time. Remember that Muhammad himself was a merchant before he experienced his revelations. Merchants remained esteemed so long as they maintained fair dealings and gave to charity in accordance with the pillars of Islam, if you remember that. And this is an image from Ibn Battuta's travels, one of the most famous Muslim merchants in history. Just back to this, I missed a couple of things from this previous slide. So another thing that's important for us to realize is that there's a very reliable and loyal military that allows for the expansion and protection of Islam. Now, soldiers oftentimes chose to remain in the armies of the caliph even once they were old enough or qualified enough that they could leave. This was because these soldiers received a regular salary from the caliphate. Now, soldiers were not allowed to own property in the areas that they conquered, but still, to be a soldier for the caliphate was a pretty good deal economically. So because of that, there were less deserters from the military, not even deserters, there were less retirees from the military, and that, of course, protected the Islamic world's territorial acquisitions. All right, slavery was permitted in the Muslim world, although Muslims were not allowed to enslave other Muslims. Jews, Christians, and Zoroastrians were also exempt from slavery. This is largely because they were all monotheistic, and we already discussed the significance of the people of the book. So slaves, in turn, were often imported from Africa, as well as Kievan Rus and Central Asia. In fact, the term slave comes from the word Slav. So there's no hereditary slavery, meaning that you do not inherit slavery just because your parents happen to be enslaved. And many slaves converted to Islam, and that would result in their freedom. So this is also very significant, and it's a major difference from the transatlantic slave trade that we're going to talk about soon. Slave women often served as concubines for Islamic men, and this was a way that men could get around the limit of having four wives. If they took a concubine, she did not count towards the grand total of spouses. Slave women were actually allowed more independence than men for the most part, and this was because they could go to markets and run errands, and in many ways they had more independence than their masters' legal wives. For example, slave women were permitted to dance, or they could perform music before men. Most wives could not. And also, slave women could have outside jobs, and if they made enough money with a second job, they could buy their freedom. This image to the left is of a slave market in Yemen, and this one is an Arabic slave market. So, women in the Islamic world. In terms of continuity and change, from Bedouin culture, women already wore head coverings. They wore veils. So this was something that existed before Islam was founded. Now, after the founding of Islam, most women continue to cover their heads, and these headscarves are called hijabs. Men also commonly wore head coverings in this Bedouin culture. Now, women in Bedouin culture could study and read, but not in the company of unrelated men. So that's a continuity into Islam in the sense that in some ways, in particular, some of the more conservative sects of Islam do not allow a large degree of freedom for women. Muhammad's treatment of women tended to be very good. He was credited for raising the status of women. Remember that Muhammad's wife was wealthy on her own merit. Muhammad insisted that dowries were paid to the future wife rather than her father. And that's actually a really big deal. Also, Muhammad forbade female infanticide. In other words, if you gave birth to a daughter, you were not allowed to kill that baby. Muhammad's first wife was educated and she owned her own business. So this sets a pattern for recognition of women's abilities. In terms of the status of Muslim women in particular, they were given a higher status than Jewish or Christian women that lived within their empire. Muslim women were allowed to inherit property and retain ownership of that property even after they got married. They could remarry if they were widowed, and if they divorced, they would receive a cash settlement. Women could also initiate divorce under certain circumstances. Women were allowed to practice birth control, and Islamic women who testified in court under Sharia law were protected from retaliation. However, if a woman testified in court, her testimony was only worth half that of a man. Most historical records created before 1450 were written by men, so that shows us that women's freedom was limited. And as the Arab world and Muslim world in general becomes larger, and cities and towns increase in population, women's rights become increasingly limited. And this is partially due to the rise of harems, which were these societies filled with women, where, how do I put this lightly? Oftentimes this was somewhat tantamount to a brothel, if you know what that is. Lastly, let's talk about the development of Sufism. Now, the Sufis could be seen as a very devout subset of Islam. They followed rituals and ecstatic chants in their attempts to unite with God. The Sufis abstained themselves from earthly pleasures, and they use whirling dances to express religious ecstasy. So oftentimes if you come across a piece of art depicting Sunni people, you will see them dancing in this spinning motion. Sufis emphasize introspection to grasp truths that they believed could not be understood through learning. So the Sufis actually emphasized that type of study over studying the Quran directly. Also, in terms of abstaining from earthly pleasures, you may notice here that Sufis do not cut their hair or trim their beards. The theory is that Sufism rose as a mystical response to the perceived lure of luxury of the early Umayyad Caliphate. So as we discussed previously, the Islamic world becomes very wealthy. In many ways, Sufism was seen as a reaction to that in terms of abandoning wealth for some of the more devoutly religious parts of Islam. So that's it for the Islamic world up until 1450. If you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comment box below. And thanks as always for watching.